under your chair.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah.
Since he Disciples made their way from Galilee, and he did not want anyone to know, because he was instructing his disciples. He was telling them, "The Son of Man will be delivered into the hands of men. They will put him to death, and 3 days after he has been put to death, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he said, and were afraid to ask him. They came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the road?" They said nothing, because perhaps they had been arguing which of them was the greatest. So he sat down, called the 12 to him and said, "If anyone wants to be first, he must make himself last of all and servant of all." He then took a little child, set him in front of them, put his arms round him, and said to them, "Anyone who welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me. And anyone who welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The followers of Jesus, on their way to Capernaum, were having an argument about who was the greatest. And so Jesus calls the 12 together and tells them that whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all. Taking a little child, he says that whoever welcomes one such child in the name of Jesus welcomes him. The whole passage is inevitably linked to the discourse at the beginning of today's Gospel reading, where Jesus announces that he's going to be delivered into human hands and killed. The reading is not so much about the attitude of the church towards children. It is more about the nature of God's commitment to us and the implications of that commitment as they affect the church. If the disciples are to follow Christ in any sense, their discipleship ought to be modeled on their leader, who is gentle and humble at heart. But more than that, their whole life from now on, in the light of the events that actually occurred in Jerusalem, should be changed by a dramatic new perception of the nature of God. For any of them who still believed that the God of Jesus was a remote, basically hostile deity, the view would be torn apart by the sight of this Son and servant of God laying down his life. This man, who even in the face of incredible suffering would not turn on his tormentors, speaks clearly of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That God here among us. Here among us, surrendering himself to us. For those who saw it and understood, their hearts turned. That is what all this is about. The heart of this man Jesus is the heart of God himself, open for us. And the resurrection that followed brought immense joy and energy for the mission. But it was this defeated corpse on a cross that sent the last word on the love of God. That open heart that made the Roman soldier a pagan, speaking when God's own people remained silent, crying, "Truly, this man was God's son." And so the Gospel isn't so much about sound, straightforward teaching about how to live a good life and gain its reward. It is more about consequences. If you believe this and this, this is how you will behave. This is how you should behave. This is how you must rationalize what goes on in the world. And this is how you might begin to change it. But it will be a battle, because there are forces at work that are stronger than you are. In order to make any headway, you yourselves must be sure where your priorities lie. Show where your strength and conviction come from. And for us to make any headway for the Gospel in a pretty apathetic world, we cannot simply condemn what we perceive as wickedness, as if we are always dealing with something self-evident. It is not good enough for Christians to say that such and such a thing is wrong because God says it is. We have to return to God's self-revelation in Jesus. We have to return to that and recognize that the heart of love which shed so much blood on the cross did so for us, for you, for me, for all, not just for a particular social stratum or ethnic or religious tradition, but for the whole world. And our first call as Christian disciples is to acknowledge that. This is how God is. The implications of that are wide. Indeed, they are for the whole of the church's life. And they put into perspective all this squabbling about sexual ethics, which has characterized the life of the church in recent years, from people who describe themselves as the mainstream of the Christian tradition. This is how God is. God defeated, exhausted, executed on a cross. Too much for the disciples to stomach, who were happier discussing their relative status as they travelled along the road. Too much for these Christians who seem to prefer the uncompromising harshness of the old law to the heart-wrenching demands of the new. To worship God is to acknowledge with all the means at our disposal the gift of his own life that our Maker constantly reassumes. And to build the community founded on Christ is to acknowledge the universality of his love for humanity and for the whole of creation. The difference between Christians and other humanists is that we can find a rationale for recognizing and responding to human value and need. And we can state that there is a purpose to creation, a creation put together and sustained by love, a vulnerable love, which at a point in time joined the created order to win it over by the same divine love. There is a long way to go, many to win over, many distortions to correct, but our mission must go on. And it must be motivated by the conviction that God himself came among us as a little, vulnerable child, gave himself wholly for our salvation, and indeed still comes, silently and unfailingly, in bread and wine. To speak gospel truth to the world is not simply to warn and threaten, but to win over hearts of those for whom the arms of Jesus reached out and still reach out from the cross. God our Father, to the God who in his Son Jesus Christ opens his heart to us. We pray that we may draw near to that heart and love the Lord with all our hearts. We pray for the Christian community throughout the world and for God's people in this place as we seek to witness to God's love and build community. Pray too for Martin, our bishop. Lord, hear us. Suffering with COVID, for all who govern and try our country, for Elizabeth our Queen and her government, and for all who take decisions that affect our lives. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
For our families, friends, neighbours and colleagues, for all who live and work in this locality, for those who visit this city, for all in sickness or distress at this time. May they feel the support of our prayer and the healing power of God's love. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
For those who have died, that they may find their fulfillment in God's eternal kingdom. Particularly for Terry Morley, priest, who died recently. For those whose anniversary of death falls at this time, rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace.
Amen.
We join our prayers to those of our patrons, St. Paul and all the saints, as we acclaim Mary, the ever virgin mother.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us
brothers and sisters, that this sacrifice that is both yours and mine may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice you have at hand.
Without them, we are praying. gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." Gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for them for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Said your apostles.
apostles, peace I make you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
our visitors here today, a reminder to everyone that there will be Mass in church on Tuesday, Wednesday and Saturday during this coming week. Wednesday is the monthly Requiem for the Departed, and a reminder that our Bishop Martin will be here on Sunday the 10th of October. I think that's it. Please take us away with you, I'll make this to remind you of what's going on. And the Mass, of course, next Sunday at 11 o'clock.
Amen.
Has ended. Go forth in peace.
Amen. Amen.